Appreciate it.
You're very welcome. Nice. Just in case.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Thank you indeed.
Okay, we should start.
Yes.
Oh, and a bagel.
With a little schmear.
So did any of you go to Jewish day school or yeshiva or any of that stuff?
Yeah, I went to Hebrew school.
Went through it? Yeah. So it must have been fairly familiar to you.
What was fairly familiar to me?
The world of this movie, I guess.
Yeah, sure. And this one did too.
I went to an Orthodox day school until sixth grade. And
they told you should be an actress.
And they told me I should be an actress. Actually, I went to day school and learned some Rashi and Ramban and had to read Torah. And then in seventh grade, I was a violinist. So I was roughly the coolest kid you've ever met. And in seventh grade, I was a violinist at a school for the performing arts. And I noticed that all the cool kids were in drama. So specifically this one boy who I saw walking down the stairs one day, I thought he was the cutest boy I'd ever seen in my life. So I auditioned for the theater program and got in. That boy is now my best friend, and he was the maid of honor in my wedding. So obviously, you know, the relationship part didn't work out. But he and his partner were here for the screening last night, and they loved the movie. But yeah, so that was how I actually ended up acting after my post Jewish day school years.
And Richard, you seem like a natural rabbi.
I was raised an anti-Semite, so I went to school for it. Actually, I went to Hebrew school, and I did not have any yeshiva or anything like that. I went to Hebrew school. Yes, I went to Saturday school. You know, it was Sunday school. Yeah. We called it Sunday school, but it was Saturday morning, and you know, that's what it was. And yeah, just the regular Reform Jew. From Yardley, Pennsylvania, from Bucks County.
It's a perfect place.
Yep.
Do you? How did the Coens approach you for this piece?
We want you.
Don't they do that?
No, I think we are. Look, if you're Brad Pitt or George Clooney, they point and they say, "We wrote this for you." This movie. Do you know who auditioned for this movie? Phil Rosenthal. Who created everybody? Raymond, yeah, I said I said anybody whose nose was a little bigger than Courtney Cox's auditioned for this movie. So everybody auditioned for it, and it just was pared down to us.
Yeah.
Well, you get the sense of that in the movie. I mean, it's certainly in the theater last night. It was the most Jewish crowd, even in Toronto.
Was it? Was it? Yes. Was a very Jewish crowd.
And the Visa Platinum card line was longer than I think for any movie ever at the Elgin.
That's hilarious. I did not know. I really didn't. I didn't. I would think it would just be a lot of movie lovers. That's what I sort of saw.
Yeah, because I was actually testing to see who was laughing at what. And there's this one line in the whole Yiddish spiel at the beginning. She says, Sinzweigen, and whatever. And I can actually remember, I can hear people in my mind saying that in my childhood. And the only person who laughed at it was my father. So I actually didn't feel, if they're Jews, they're fakers. They're fake. Yeah, they're Visa card holders, but they're not real Jews.
Yeah, I didn't get the sense. When we
were definitely a generation or two removed from Yiddish.
Well, that's
I'm not. You are?
Well, I definitely am. But it was funny that they opened the movie with the Christmas parade.
Yeah, that was
I agree
funny.
With you.
Yeah, that comment is not missed on
hilarious.
Anybody. Uh-huh.
That
yeah.
killed me. He killed
uh-huh.
me.
Yeah. I could hear Joel and Ethan snorting from the corner, actually. Yeah. I heard the yeah.
So you were pretty your first thing is, I mean, Richard does a lot of theater, and I'm sure you do some theater also, yes? But you're Mr. Theater in New York. You're like the king of the stage. The last couple of years, you're like the up-and-coming next guy in theater. And now you're doing this movie.
And now it's Eclipse. Now you're the up-and-coming movie guy.
Yeah.
You just never made it, did you?
You just haven't arrived.
Oh, you got so close.
You're waiting for your Carey Mulligan moment. But but is that, I mean, what is doing movies part of what you were planning? And it's just fate?
I guess so. I mean, I just love to work. And I would have loved to have done more film and television earlier on in my life. It just didn't happen for me. I didn't know what I was doing, really. I just, you know, kept doing plays because that's sort of what I went to school to do, and I loved doing it, and I would audition on occasion for you know, TV and film, but I wasn't trained in it, so I didn't know really what I was doing when a camera was turned on. So I've had to learn over the course of years, sort of trial by fire.
And it's just taken me this long to figure it out, I guess. And then I've had this opportunity. So.
When
we still don't know if he's figured out how to do it.
Yeah.
Maybe his next movie.
I'm still working on
he'll
it.
Get good.
When you're a kid, you want to be a movie star. And when you get older, you want to be an actor. Mm. So that really is. And I know it's reminiscent of Peter O'Toole's line, but like he said, we want to work. And work doesn't always come as good as the movie that we are in, mm-hmm. but a lot of times the theater that we do is great because many, especially if we do, let's say, a revival, they're not going to revive a lousy play.
Right.
You're going to do a good play, but it's that's where our love really is because mm-hmm. when you do theater, there's a sense of the real craft of what you're doing. And that is something that the three of us, I'd speak for them both, for the other two, that's what we love.
Well, I saw you, Michael, in Hamlet last year,
oh.
one of the seven Hamlets in New York
yeah,
last
exactly.
year. And I
yeah.
thought yours was actually tremendous. And nice. It was a fascinating energy performance.
Mm.
And it kind of ultimately is fairly reminiscent in some ways of this movie
huh.
and the energy that they bring to it, though your performance is quite different.
Mm.
Do you see, is your character in this Hamlet in
no,
some way?
No. No way. Hamlet's going through some troubling circumstances as well. But no, I hadn't really thought about that before. Someone who's trying to, in a situation that he's trying to find his way out of, so I guess in that situation, he's also, I guess, you know, they're both, someone said this morning that they thought of Larry as a tragic hero.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, that's interesting. I mean, he does, in undergrad, I was taught that a tragic hero has a fatal flaw. And I guess with Larry, it's, making, towards the end of the movie, making a decision that's not perhaps ethically or morally, justified. I don't know, I guess I hadn't really thought about it before, but it's an interesting comparison.
Well, it's they always, the boys, the missing boys, they always seem to find the, Shakespearean level stuff underneath all the zany things that are going on
sure.
the surface in their work. And you're kind of a tragic figure on some level in this picture.
Oh, my gosh, yes. Tragic, pathetic, it's when I see the movie, here's something that I thought of last night is, you never get to, you never have an emotional breakdown. I do let it go, and that's really I thought was interesting.
Mm.
I get to let it out. I can't handle the pressure, and I let go. You never do.
Not to such an extent, yeah.
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 Yeah, I mean, you do. You yell. You pound the table.
Yeah, it starts to leak out
times.
A little in Besher and Spence's office.
Right. Yes, a little bit. Yeah, yes, of
some,
course.
There's yeah. some bricking down there's of some, the wall that is Larry.
Yeah, but truly,
yeah.
a cathartic,
yeah.
Emotional breakdown is I'm permitted it.
Which you are too. Everybody really in the movie gets to have their moment.
Their moment.
Oh, that's true.
Breaking
that's
down.
Right. Moment of yeah. breaking down. That was actually my favorite stuff. I think my best work is off camera. That was my favorite. That was my most triumphant moment. They saw me when I walked out of doing that. I just did the voiceover. I thought, I keep seeing, like, page after page, it's Judith wailing. I'm like, Judith wails. Judith wails like an animal. I'm like, oh, when does Judith wail? Like, who does that and when does that happen? No one mentions it. Weeks go by. I'm like, and I ask Bob Graff one day, like, do you know when Judith wails? I just want to be on my game that day. And he's like, oh, we'll get to it. Well, ask Joel and he, yeah, good. Yeah, well, yeah, good. Okay, when?
Do you remember doing it?
So yeah, it was the very
some
last
some little
day,
back
right?
room.
It was a back room. It was an old synagogue where we were shooting the
theater. Little small little room with boxes piled on each other, and we go in the corner.
We went in, and you did all
and
of your off-camera.
And I just did, I'll be out in a minute.
For
50, in a minute.
57 times, and I love Richard keeps going, wait, you guys, one more take. I'm going to do it again. And it comes out like this.
Out in a minute.
No, 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 wait, I'm going to change it up this time, you guys. Hold on, let me give me a second, and it comes out like this.
Out in a minute.
Uh-huh. So I got to watch the glory that is the process of Richard Kind. I mean, I got to see it firsthand. It's a masterclass. It's really, truly. Forget his Hamlet. I think that one line of yours off camera. So Joel and Ethan
they
say...
they did use it 27 times, to be fair.
Thank God, it was such a nice performance.
Actually, uh-huh. then one time I went, I'll be out in a minute. Like that, and they have my performance because it's not in script form. We didn't act it out, and then they just took whichever one they want. So I mean, truly, they modulate my performance.
They really did
through voice editing.
But because the I wasn't actually in the script, it's not actually in the movie. They didn't even let you stutter. I mean, it's like as scripted, done, finished. Yeah, but, yep. Cut, it's done. So we were in the back room, and I was wailing, and Ethan said, "Great, yeah, so you're just gonna cry, so whatever you need to do, yeah, just roll around on the floor." Like, okay, and they were like, "Do you need a minute?" No, let's just do this. So I start wailing, hysterical, I'm sobbing, they're laughing, I'm like puking, I'm crying so hard. And I finish, and I perhaps think I've given the performance of a lifetime, and I'm done, and I'm shaking, and they're like, "Yeah, great. Okay, now we really want you to cry." Sweet Jesus, really? Okay, sorry, I can't say Jesus, really? He was a Jew, it's fine. So now I really go for it, and at that point I thought I was gonna vomit. I think I did a little bit by the time you guys saw me, but yeah.
I love
that was my catharsis.
Wish I could have kissed you then.
I thought it was actually one of the great laugh lines in the movie where one of the kids says, "Jesus Christ," something happens. It's like only in a Jew movie could you say that and it's okay.
Yeah.
So what is the magic of the Coen brothers? Is it that the script is just that great and then they just know how to stick the camera where it needs to be and let you do your work? Or is there a lot of hands-on wrestling with you about exactly where you're going to be tonally? Because this is such a tone poem, this picture. Mm.
That's, you know, what you just said is a lot of it. You know, they write these brilliant stories, and each one is different, and their visual sense is extraordinary, and their
collaboration,
and, you know, they let their actors do what they do and keep their hands off them, and if they need guidance, they give it to them.
But yeah, the word wrestle is the furthest thing from it, because I don't think that they do. We were lucky, we did get 2 days of rehearsal with them, and rehearsal was sitting across a table, reading the scenes, and then talking about not what it means, because they'll be the last person to tell you what it means. I mean, I know that they're very elusive during their interviews, but you know, they don't want concrete answers at all, but they want interpretation, and they're coming to us for our interpretation of their words and to represent the characters. And like when I had to cry during the pool scene, you know, I said, "You want real tears? Yeah, I think we do. All right." And you know, because when I auditioned, I did that scene, but I didn't have the I couldn't bring it up. But I knew what they want. And then, you know, I in order to figure out, for me, Uncle Arthur, phone!
I think it's mine. I think my purse is in here.
Okay, well, it'll ring out.
Way to be a theater person.
Where
let
is
your
it?
Phone go.
Here you go.
I forgot my purse is in here.
This is horrible. This is professional.
Siri, why'd you have to go and ruin Toronto?
And my story.
Your story.
My story was it was important. My story could life change.
Okay.
Anyway, Arthur was somebody who I really had to ask questions about, especially the word mentaculous. I can't even remember if the word mentaculous exists or did they make it up.
I think it was an actual word named for a book that a genius friend of theirs
wrote. But I don't know whether the word exists in the English language.
That I don't know either.
Yeah, I have no idea.
Way to dot your I's and cross your T's, you two. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Someone should have looked that up.
But isn't that sort of elusive answer in my thing? It's just for me, so you can interpret it. Anyway.
There are a lot of things I've never asked them, like about, you know, what was your mother like? I hear around town in Minneapolis that she was a lovely woman, but I mean,
yeah, but you weren't necessarily their mother.
Right, that's what I'm saying. So. And I've never asked them, like, was your mother a nice lady? She must have been. You're a very nice voice.
But I did ask them about, you know, we were in Minneapolis, so I did ask them about what was it like and stuff like that. What was your childhood like now that I see this world? And, you know, I wanted to get to know them. Like, you know, there's a curiosity. But they would, you know, they would talk like guys would talk, you know.
Did you shoot locations or was everything on stages?
Locations.
Lots of locations.
Because the production design is amazing. But
unbelievable.
Because I went to those schools too, in Baltimore and Miami. So.
Yeah. Miami?
Yeah.
I'm from Miami originally.
Miami Beach.
Miami Beach.
Ransom Everglades.
Ransom Everglades. Okay, not far from me. I'm from Pinecrest. Well, they call it Pinecrest now. Isn't that absurd?
Yeah, well.
Pinecrest. I know. It's South Florida. It's South Miami. And I went to Palmetto, that hellhole. What? Not a nice school. What? It was. It's so nice now. As far as. How they work, what makes them so brilliant is they're actually extremely clear about what they want. Mm-hmm. And what they want was us and everybody else. And so it's not that we're so good, it's that they're so proud of themselves for choosing us. So we just have to show up and say the lines. It's pretty much what I think it comes down to. They're so specific about everything. They're so clear about their vision. They're so clear about the script, so clear about the production design. And they were so clear about wanting who they wanted. And the whole supporting cast, watching the screening last night, I leaned over to my husband. I was like, holy, I'm the weak link in this chain. These people are awesome.
Yeah,
but God, this group of people, the kids, I mean, the whole thing. And I live in Minneapolis, so I run into the kids all the time, like all the extra kids and the other boys on the bus. Mm. Every single, performance, because they knew exactly what they wanted. So what I would say is sort of the defining thing for me watching them is that they are so clear, they have such clear vision, that really it's a matter of showing up and saying your lines. And everybody wants to make them proud. I have never felt so strongly about making anybody proud, except maybe my mother last night. Mm. But there was really nothing I could do. I'd already made the movie. If she hated it, God bless, go back to Miami, Mom.
And you guys had seen the movie already before going last night, or?
Yeah, I've seen it once.
I had seen it twice.
I saw it in a screening room that I didn't like seeing because there were like two people in the three people there. So, and I think it's a communal movie. I think it's very fun.
So how was that experience last night?
It's great to hear hundreds of people enjoying the movie as opposed to just, you know, 5 or 10 people. You got a sense of how the movie might play out in the real world, and that's what I've been waiting for a long time, which was nice.
I did not get, there were laughs that I thought are hilarious, like when I'm draining my cyst. And no laughs, and I'm going, oh, no, why? And I said to Ethan, I told him, I said, I got to tell you. And then the one scene where you ask, am I looking for a place, and have you found one? No. I couldn't have done it any better.
Right.
It was exactly how I wanted it done. I thought that the way it was shot, I thought the way that we asked our questions, and I gave the answer, and terse, and everything, I thought it was perfect, comically perfect. Not a laugh. Crickets.
But you know what?
I went to Ethan and I said, I don't know. And he goes, sometimes the audience is just wrong. Because Ethan thought it was right too. But what were you going to say? Sorry.
No, that's okay. Besides the fact that different people have different senses of humor and different people will find different things funny, the music in this film that was written by Carter Burwell, and also the incidental music, like under that scene, the folk music, the Sidor Bilarski, beautiful folk tunes, it adds like this...
A melancholy?
Impending doom.
There's a melancholy that's underneath it that in some ways, in some senses, tones some of the comedy down and it adds a melancholy aspect to it. Mm-hmm. Whereas if it were without that music, it might be different.
Were there places you got big laughs that you didn't expect them?
There were a couple of places in the movie.
Yeah.
I wasn't expecting people to laugh as much. And I love that they do.
Yeah. I'll tell you, when I drink the high C, I actually wish. That killed me. When we were doing it, it is exactly as disgusting as, it was the most hard, nothing. And it's like a nightmare to you. You're sleeping at the table after grading the books or going through with Judith talking about the whoopsie-doopsie and everything. And then he wakes up and there's this grotesque with the hand on the cyst and drinking high C out of the refrigerator in shadow. That killed me. That absolutely killed me. Nothing. They took me way too seriously.
Well, it's definitely a Coen Brothers thing that people take a while to catch up with a movie, usually the second or third time they've seen it.
Maybe, I hope that they
even
do.
When you're in that.
I
even
hope
when
that
you're
resonates.
In the movie and you know every single line of the screenplay backwards and forwards, it's the same thing.
I hope that will resonate comically because it just killed me. And they kept in the gulping sound. You know, when you drink out of that big can, you remember with the thing?
Yeah.
I mean, I really gulped it. It's so disgusting. When I saw it last night.
Good thing you find it funny.
I do. So, I find it funny. It was exactly as gross because I've got the...
But the music's still going. It's really true. Okay, that really does set the tone. It's impending doom.
All right. Really?
I'm sorry, we're doing signals around your head and around, trying to figure out the scheduling as we go through this whole process.
Can you take my purse out of here just in case? It rang before, and I'm embarrassed.
Before it explodes.
We were talking a lot about Miami and stuff.
Thank you.
We'll go.
That's what took up all the time was Miami?
You.
Seriously?
Okay. Not all our time. Your. Go ahead.
So does it become a family? I mean, these guys seem like a family now. Is it pretty much a family on that set? Is it that the...
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, well, first of all, you got to understand, most of these people have been with, most of the crew have been with the guys since at least Fargo, maybe even from the beginning.
Yeah.
They all work in concert with those guys, and the two of them are not just a two-headed animal, they are a one-eyed animal. It's astounding. Mm-hmm. So that's another reason why their days are, you know, their days are very, you know, 9, 10 hours, maybe 12 hours, never anything overtime. I'm going to tell you something else that you'll find interesting is when an actor goes on set, when everybody goes on set, they have what's called sides, which are Xeroxed copies of the script that's being shot that day, so that you know what's going to be shot and you see the lines, everything like that. These guys have, before the movie even starts, it's been storyboarded. Mm-hmm. And so they know exactly what angles, they know what they're going to shoot. They include the storyboards in the side so that you truly are included in the collaborative artistic process. Mm-hmm. And that's never, truly never done. But they run a liberal shooting day. And when I say liberal, I mean that not in its political terms, but they are very family. The only thing they lead is that they are the leaders who lead down that everything is equal. Everybody is just as important as everybody else.
Does it change how you act having that information or just how you feel about being there every day?
I actually felt really freed by it. I mean, you know, I'm not
liberation.
My background, obviously, all of our training is in theater. You don't ad lib Shakespeare, so awesome. So when you get, you know, a Coen Brothers script and there are three dots, you honor those three dots. Yeah. I actually like that. I like having, you know, some lines within which to color. I actually really found that freeing. I found it very freeing to know what I was shooting each day, what the images were, because then that gave you all sorts of flexibility and freedom. And then they're so confident in your choices, you just don't want to blow it at that point. Yeah. But you know exactly what you're going to be doing that day and what you're going to be saying. And if you have any, there's really no difference in terms of, we've talked about this, in terms of people want to know, like, Joel versus Ethan. The only thing that's kind of slightly different is that if you have a concern with a word, I don't know if you guys found this, you generally discuss that with Ethan. Mm. And if there is whoever calls cut and action, it's always Joel who calls action and cut. Other than that, there's no difference, right hand, left hand, all one God.
And you get surprised when you saw the final product? Is there anything that you didn't expect from, I mean, you obviously had read the script, but were there surprises?
There were a couple of things that were cut from the script that didn't end up in the final.
Everything of mine was cut. The one thing. No.
Whole performance. Well, everything that was
funny. Every scene, it wasn't. Well, there were two things that were cut that were very interesting. One was, are we allowed to curse in this?
Please do.
Is at the pool when I go, don't you blame me, you fucker? I thought that was a great cut. It was always aberrant in the scene, and I would do it in a different way. Because it just didn't go with the flow, but they obviously wanted something, but I thought it was a good cut. The other one that really upset me, because I thought that it was great for the character, but they said the way that it was shot was so jarring, is when I'm brought by the police to the house, and you know, and I'm going, I didn't do anything, and I turn around and I go, well, hi, Mrs. Samsky. I loved that because I'm just so protesting, and I'm with the police, and then right behind me I see Mrs. Samsky. And all of a sudden, I literally change and I become this beatific child. And it was just too jarring. So I do turn around and say, hi, Mrs. Zansky, and she says, hi, Arthur. But I wish that it had worked, because mm-hmm. I thought it was, I thought that would have resonated a little bit.
What did they cut of yours?
They cut, there's a scene that I had on the telephone with Mimi Nudel, the woman at the lake.
Right, right.
I have a scene with her where she invites me to the lake over the phone, which they felt like it just didn't need to be there because right. it was extraneous. And the very end of the movie.
I remember that from the mm-hmm. script.
There was a moment, after Larry gets the call from his doctor, they show him driving in the rain,
oh,
sort
right.
of like, you know, with that sort of look in his mm-hmm. face as to, when we shot a whole section of me driving in the rain, that was cut from the movie, which I had hoped it would be in there just to sort of give it a final moment, but they didn't think it was necessary, as they like to keep things sort of open-ended. Mm-hmm. They felt like the phone call was enough.
I think there'll definitely be people doing the Larry.
Doing the Larry?
Getting that Larry look on their face.
Well, what's know. That? Doing the Larry. Pants are up too high?
You know
what's
what?
The Larry?
I thought that everything was said in the last moment.
Yeah.
I think they felt so too.
Which is why we have editors and we're not in charge of editing.
Exactly.